I am the Urban Botanist. I am an Ottawa-based small business owner and nature fanatic. I love all things green and growing. That started at a very young age for me. Cue pictures of me as a child. Boom. I've always loved anything creepy, crawly, bugs, mushrooms, frogs, knee-deep in the swamp looking for things. And it's really from there that I started this deep spiral into the wonderful green world around us, and that very much has gotten into mushrooms. So I'm excited to be sharing that with you today. But what else is the Urban Botanist? The Urban Botanist is a business that I started. The Urban Botanist is Green Thumb Workshops. We have been running workshops all weekend long at the Lee Valley Tools booth that we have just back here. We're doing moss frame workshops, terrarium workshops, where we basically are teaching you how to grow your green thumb, how to get crafty. We love to inspire and educate people on how to engage with nature on a regular basis, which I think is so important and something that has particularly been lacking, especially over the last 2.5 years. Am I right? Anybody really like missing that, craving that, needing that? These mushroom kits, just you wait. But that's really what the Urban Botanist is. We also have a nature series. No big deal. I'm going to play the trailer for episode 2, which was all about mushrooms. It's available on the Urban Botanist YouTube channel. It's just a short little 30-second trailer. That's going to be coming up next, which is We Are Workshops. Amazing. We love workshops. And we're also a YouTube nature series. So let's go ahead and play that trailer, that clip. Get us geared up for mushroom talk.
I am so excited to be getting my hands dirty, going outside with our expert, Ruthie. We will not only be learning how to forage and use our 5 senses for foraging for mushrooms and other local edible species, but we will also be learning how to actually use those foraged items in your everyday cooking.
Oh, can I try to catch it?
Yeah.
Okay.
That was me.
Fail.
See, and see how it stayed together?
That one stayed fully together.
Yeah, that's a beautiful lion's mane.
These tacos. They're so cute.
This is amazing.
Cheers.
All about mushrooms. If you really want to dive on in, it's kind of a weird, quirky. We talk about cooking, how to forage and use those foraged items to create tacos, mousses. Like you wouldn't honestly believe all the different things that you can do with mushrooms. So this now brings me to our star guest of the evening, Mrs. Deb Kelly. Please join me on stage. She is a mushroom farmer, a fungi fanatic, and all things expert in the world of mushrooms. And she is also one of the co-owners of the Fungi Connection, which is a Kingston-based mushroom farm. Welcome, Deb.
Hi, thank you. Good to be here. Thanks, everybody.
Another round of applause for Deb. She came all the way out here. We're so excited to have you and talk about, look at all these mushrooms up here. I'm so, so pumped. And one of the first things that I want to ask you, Deb, is how did you get into mushrooms? Like, where did this stem from? How did you get into the world, the wonderful world of mushrooms?
Well, it's funny because as a kid, I was in one of those families that is very much afraid of mushrooms. We don't eat them. We don't get them from the woods. They will all kill you. And the only mushrooms I knew growing up were the ones that came in the can, the little rubbery ones, you know. And my mom hates mushrooms. So, but I've always also been into creepy crawlies, and I was the kid on the playground trying to catch grasshoppers when all my friends were swinging or whatever. And just as I grew up, I decided to get focused on growing. I wanted to grow things for my living. So we started with all kinds of other things, greenhouses. I've got the whole history. If you want to know more about that, happy to talk about it. And then about 8 years ago, my partner and I decided, how hard could it be to grow mushrooms? And that's when it began.
And how hard is it on a scale from one? I mean, we're going to talk about how you start a mushroom farm, truly. Yeah. I mean, it's not easy. It's not an overnight thing, not like anything else.
No.
But I'm curious to know, like, what is one of your earliest memories of a mushroom? Like, one of your earliest memories of interacting with nature when you first saw a mushroom and was like, Wow, that's kind of cool. What is that?
Well, one of the things, I didn't grow up here in Ontario. I'm actually an American. I grew up in Indiana. And in Indiana, the big thing in the spring, early spring, is morel hunting. And even though I don't come from an outdoorsy family, I grew up around lots of kids, lots of families that would go out in the woods and search for morel, bring them back, clean them all up. So that was probably my first experience of these things grow in the forest and you can fry them up and eat them. But again, it was one of those things in my particular family. Just no, that's a little scary. But you know, I was always into compost, and compost is very close to my heart. I could spend all day talking about compost. And so I think,
for another day, for another chat,
another day. Right. But I think when we started looking into growing mushrooms, it was all about getting the right compost and starting to really see what kind of nutrition we could bring and
sure,
these guys.
Sure. Yep. Absolutely. And morels would be such a tasty introduction into the world of mushrooms for sure. Has anybody here ever foraged or tried morels before? Delightful, delicious, expensive, so worth it to go out and look for your own,
for sure.
And that's kind of a great lead into my next funny slide, or no, that one's coming after. Okay. But here we have Darren. This is your
partner of 16 years, Darren Kelly. And he's looking very serious, because when it comes to growing, he's all serious.
He
takes it very seriously. So this was one of our first, fruiting rooms, as we were still kind of dabbling and starting to get into, and we're working with blue oyster mushrooms there, which is in the larger picture as well.
And this picture that you see on the right or on the left, the bag that you see the mushrooms growing out of, these are some of, and something I'd never seen or heard of before. And especially if you're a fungi fanatic and you love using mushrooms in the kitchen, when you realize that you can very easily grow your own fresh mushrooms in about the same amount of space that a dinner plate takes up, they're not smelly, they're not high maintenance, they grow super quickly. I was mind blown. I couldn't believe that this was a thing.
Right.
Well, and we're going to chat about that.
Yeah. And one of the things that brings up for me is most people in North America, we're so familiar with button mushrooms and portobello mushrooms. And what we know about mushrooms is, oh, they grow in the dark and they grow in manure, kind of stinky and gross.
That's what you first think about.
That's exactly right. Right. But what we always forget about is all of these mushrooms that grow on wood. They're 90% of the mushrooms that we know grow in the forest, and they use wood or, you know, debris on the forest floor as their nutrition. So these blocks, I get this question a lot, so I just wanted to bring it up right up front. There's no manure in these blocks. These are
poo-free.
Poo-free.
Poo-free blocks.
Hardwood sawdust.
Come get them.
Yeah. So
cool. Yeah. And I want to talk more about the substrate, but I just thought it was so interesting to show that here, and kind of going back to thinking about all the different types of mushrooms that exist. Of course, there is probably a lot of question that you get regularly.
All the time. Yeah.
Absolutely. There are tasty and nutritious mushrooms. And I kind of always feel the need to touch upon this whenever talking about mushrooms. Surely you do too.
All the time.
Is you never consume a mushroom that you haven't 100% correctly identified, because yes, there are tasty and nutritious mushrooms. There are mushrooms that will be the last mushroom you ever eat. And then there are mushrooms that unravel the very fabric of reality. If we know those kind of special mushrooms, which we're not growing those up here.
We're not growing those.
Those are for another day, but we are talking about delicious, edible, and heavily medicinal.
Yes, very nutritious. Very
nutritious. Yield, for example, like this is an Amanita, is that right?
Amanita muscaria, yep.
And I love this quote, all fungi are edible, but some fungi are only edible once. One and done. So you really, you know, I kind of should have started out the talk with this. It's like a precursor. We're not telling you to just go out and start popping mushrooms and tasting them all. It's not like a charcuterie board in the forest for you to just go and dibble and dabble. You really do want to make sure that you're identifying these mushrooms correctly. However, there are several species, almost 100, if not more, in Ontario
easily.
Edible.
Easily. And one of the things, you know, you met with Ruthie, which Ruthie is one of also my friends back in Kingston, and she is a foraging expert. So people a lot of times come to my stand and they say, oh, I found this mushroom. Can I eat it? They'll bring me a picture. And my guidance is always, I can't say for sure, because I don't consider myself a foraging expert. There are a couple and I mean a couple, I feel safe with when I go foraging. And I always send a picture to Ruthie first. And she usually says, hey, do a spore print and just make sure. There are great guides out there. If you go out in the forest and you want to find some mushrooms, take a good guidebook with you.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, and follow the instructions. But yeah. And one of the reasons that we like doing this is because when we cultivate mushrooms, we grow them, you know exactly what you're getting. That's a lion's mane mushroom. It's nothing else. So you don't have to worry
about it. You're not guessing. You're like, what is this maybe growing out the side of the bag? It's 100% guaranteed the exact variety, the exact species of mushroom that you're claiming it to be. And we have quite the variety of mushrooms up here. What are some of these? This one here is probably, anybody in the crowd recognize this one?
You know what that is?
Yell it out.
Look at this delicious, delightful mushroom.
What's that? No.
Oyster?
Close.
No. Good guess.
There you go.
Shiitake. He knows he's a chef.
That's a shiitake.
The chefs will know.
Right.
Delicious, delightful shiitake. Look at that fresh shiitake.
And shiitake is one mushroom that will grow in our climate. You can actually grow them outdoors using a plug spawn, but they're not native to Ontario. They are native to the Far East, but they become so common in cuisine that and people just love that umami flavor.
yum. I love these. Let's go chat about another one of these. Let's see if anyone in the crowd can guess this. This one's my favorite. And these do grow in Ontario.
They do.
If you ever see these growing off the side of a tree, they're one of the easiest ones to obviously...
They are. Yeah.
Identify,
yeah.
Because they have such a unique look to them. And most people wouldn't even realize that that's a mushroom.
Yeah, exactly.
Anybody know what this mushroom is? Guess this mushroom. What was it?
Somebody said puffball, but it's not a puffball.
Not a puffball.
We get that
ball. Close.
Yep. There, this gentleman.
Lion's mane. That's right. Yep. Let's talk about some of the medicinal properties of this mushroom.
Yeah, so
that is amazing for your brain.
Yeah, lion's mane is one of those that we get a lot of attention because people, sometimes their first experience even hearing about lion's mane is through supplements that you would take for your health. Mm. Lion's mane have actually been included in a lot of research, university studies in recent years for their cognitive boost ability. They actually are a nerve growth stimulator, which if any of you are familiar with, nerves in the brain, a myelin sheath. This guy is your go-to. Good for memory, good for...
Yeah. Memory, early onset of Alzheimer's.
Dementia. Sorry?
Multiple sclerosis,
yeah.
Sure.
There's all kinds... And the research is ongoing. This is still a pretty fresh realm, so all kinds of good stuff coming down the line.
You can never have... All of our memories are slowly deteriorating, especially over the last 2 years. I'm like, where is time gone?
Right.
What year is it?
And it's delicious. This stuff
is
one of my favorites for my vegan and vegetarian customers. This guy is a wonderful meat substitute because it's super mild and it takes on the seasoning of whatever you're working with. So
totally. It has a very, very mild and a nice... soft texture.
Yeah.
Some people don't really love the texture of mushrooms. I find this one delightful. And
agreed.
You get a lot of fresh mushroom from these grow blocks.
Very dense. Yeah. Very dense.
A lot. So what I've even done with mine is I've torn it up into small pieces and let it just dehydrate. Lee Valley Tools has fabulous dehydrators that you can use as well.
Yeah.
And just dehydrate them. And they're very easy to rehydrate, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. They're great in soups, stews. They're going to soak up all that sauce, anything that you're cooking with. So... you can freeze them. Their cellular structure obviously isn't going to hold up as nicely, so I don't know that you get that nice meaty texture after they've been frozen. But
I think you're just as good, just as well off to dry it.
Dry it,
honestly,
is great.
Like this is just dried turkey tail
that I have
in a bag. I've had it for months.
Yep.
Completely fine. I'm making a DIY tincture out of it because, hello,
turkey tail. It's good stuff.
Friday nights are crazy for me at home. I make DIY mushroom tincture. But yes, they're easy enough to store, just dry in a bag.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're able to rehydrate them. We talk about that a lot in the nature series that we showed you a clip of earlier, which is on the Urban Botanist YouTube channel. But let's talk about another one of these. I'm not going to give you an easy one because some of these are easy. Let's go with the weird and wonderful and just like whimsical.
Yes.
Mushroom. Yeah, this is a mushroom. Hello. Any guesses?
If anybody guesses this, I'll be...
If anyone guesses this, I don't know what you're going to get, but you're going to get something. Dragon's tongue. I love that.
That's a great one.
I love that. Monster fingers. What do you call the way that this is growing?
This is the antler version.
Yeah,
so these are actually reishi, and I don't know if any of you have ever heard of reishi.
Reishi mushrooms.
And what I like to say is, again, this is one of those friends that comes to us from the Far East, but it also grows wild in Ontario. When you see it in the wild, you're going to see it, it's going to look like a plate or a shelf mushroom. So it's going to be rounded with
Ganoderma.
Ganoderma lucidum.
Lucidum.
Yeah, yeah, or lucidum. So lucidum. Depending on the spelling, some people. But the little white edge is going to be on the outside edge of the round growing out of a log. The way we grow these in our facility is we grow them in a high CO2 environment. So you get these long antlers because it's fun and because, it's a better way to keep it from getting contaminated with other things as it's growing because it's a slow grower.
This is how I grew mine.
Yeah, yeah.
And this is how the shelves are so beautiful when they grow out the sides.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, they're gorgeous.
Yeah, they're gorgeous. We're going to play with that at our new facility. But with this too, it's very susceptible to the light. It's going to grow toward the light. So because it's such a slow grower, when you're growing this at home, you can actually shift it, turn it, and then you'll get this nice spiral grow. So you can do all kinds of fun things. There's a lot of artists working with it.
And this one grows a little bit slower than the other ones. Like lion's mane, for example, you can have this fresh mushroom fully grown and ready to harvest within a week.
Yeah, two weeks.
So it's not something you have to wait for where... Right.
Reishi's
a little longer.
About 3 months, yeah, to get it all the way. But the cool thing about reishi, and people ask me, oh, how do you prepare it? Well, it's not a culinary mushroom. It's a medicinal, purely medicinal mushroom. So
teas.
Yeah, teas, tinctures. In the East, they call it the mushroom of immortality. I don't guarantee immortality, but... You can take it, make a tincture, make your tea, grind it up, dry it. It lasts for a long time.
Yeah. Is that not the translation of reishi?
Well, I think so.
It's immortality, which is pretty incredible. It's one of the most incredible mushrooms, one of the most incredible things that you can consume as a human being, in my opinion.
Great immune
boosting.
Not an
expert, but...
It's known as an antigen. I'm going to say it wrong. But
antioxidant.
Yeah, well, that as well. And immune boosting, and it also helps remove the stress hormones and all these good things.
So, sure. Yeah. I mean, another reason to love mushrooms. Yeah. Another reason to love mushrooms. Okay, I'm going to show another one. Let's see if we've got a right guess in the crowd. These ones are fun.
I know. They're tricky because they're little babies.
Any guesses of this? Beautiful. Look at the gorgeous growth and the color on this. Mm-hmm. Any guesses to what this mushroom is? Name that mushroom.
Yeah. Who said oysters?
Oysters. Yeah. We got a mushroom freaking pro in the crowd. That's right.
Oysters.
These are blue oysters. Mm-hmm. And I didn't realize there were different colored oysters because...
Oh. Yeah.
I'm kind of ruining it, but this is our blue oyster.
Yeah.
Here, do you want to hold that one just to compare the two?
I've got it. Yeah.
Kind of.
And these do grow in the wild around Ontario.
And then these pink oyster mushrooms.
Little baby pink oyster.
Look at these little cuties. It looks like coral.
I know. And by tomorrow, these guys will be double that size.
They grow so quickly.
Yeah. Yeah.
They're gorgeous. A little bit of misting.
Yep.
Mist. That's all you really need to do.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about how these grow blocks actually work.
Yeah.
But to show you some examples of what you can grow at home with these types of grow blocks, I mean, look at the options here. Look at them.
Yep.
And they have quite a different flavor profile, don't they?
A little bit, yeah. And now we've done some blind taste testing where we've cooked up some pinks, cooked up some blues, eaten them side by side. Can't always tell, but of course, I'm not a chef, but I know lots of people say that the pink oysters have a little bit of a seafood undertone. I have people who definitely have their favorites. The blue we find really mild. It goes well with just anything. Anytime I have a recipe that calls for wild mushrooms or button mushrooms or portobellas, I go with the blues or the pinks if I have them on hand.
They're so gorgeous. I mean, you really can't go wrong and try them all. Like Pokemon, gotta catch them all, gotta try them all. I've actually kind of got that way with foraging, and I'm curious. Mm-hmm. Do you have a species of mushroom that you like dream about growing someday?
I do.
Like your goal dream mushroom.
I do. So right now I'm sort of obsessed with maitake, which is the Griffola frondosa. It's coming. We have the culture. And this is another one that grows wild here in Ontario. Usually the Griffola frondosa is also known as not chicken of the woods. That's a different mushroom, but hen of the woods. So maitake grows usually in the fall. Sometimes you'll see it on a stump growing as like a little beautiful flowery, I think they call it dancing mushroom or something like that in some cultures, because it has these like fronds that go out like little skirts. Not only is it a beautiful mushroom, it's delicious. Chefs are just crazy about it. It's good for you as well.
It smells amazing.
Yeah.
I've foraged for fresh maitake and it has this just, it's almost a pungent scent, but it's delicious in stews.
Yeah.
In cooking. Yep. Yep. A lot of mushrooms is fabulous for vegans, vegetarians. Yeah. They make great substitutes.
Absolutely.
For meat. You know, it has that umami taste, that flavoring.
And the texture gives you that chew feel if you can't get that, you know.
Totally. Totally. So let's talk a little bit about these grow kits, how they work. We're going to do a demonstration on how to start a grow kit, what one looks like when you first receive it.
I know this is one of those things where
weird looking bag, but
if you get it as a Christmas gift and you open it up and you say,
I got one for my brother for Christmas.
You know, like
he's like, thanks. What is this?
I think, right?
But he loved it.
So what is in this bag? This is the substrate, which is, again, hardwood sawdust. And sometimes we supplement with wheat bran, depending on the recipe, a little bit of water. So there's got some weight to it. But the white that you see in there is mushroom mycelium, which mycelium, if you haven't heard of it, is the roots of the mushroom. This is the stuff that is all under our feet. It kind of ties the soil together, works with trees and plants, helps deliver nutrients to plants. Mycelium is amazing. That's another talk for another time. I could go for hours. But anyways, so that's what you're seeing in here. This white stuff is the mycelium that we've planted in, and then it has colonized the block. So this is like a solid, solid block of mycelium. And all it's waiting for is the right conditions to fruit. The mushroom is actually the reproductive body of the mycelial, the vegetative base. So when the mushroom comes out, it's saying, oh, it's the right conditions. I'm ready to fruit, spread my spores, make some more mushrooms. And so what we do when you have this grow kit at home, here, where can I set that up there?
Make some mushroom.
Yeah.
And we don't have mushroom up here.
Oh, no. We didn't even plan that. Blocks. It also comes with very detailed instructions, and you're going to get what I like to call the, mushrooms going everywhere.
Mushrooms
flying. The
highly
technical humidity tent, which is essentially a plastic bag. Some people will use a little terrarium or a little, maybe if they've got a little greenhouse that they use for their plants, lots of indoor growing. You can set it over the mushroom block because what you're trying to achieve is, thank you, you're trying to achieve like that springtime, humidity, moist environment so that the mushrooms will want to fruit. So when you get your block home, you're going to turn it on its side. Sorry. And you're going to take
a microphone while you talk.
And you're going to take a sharp knife or scissors and just give it a little, just going to cut right into the plastic. I don't know if you can see what I'm doing there. I just made an incision. And even if you cut the mycelium, you're not going to harm it because this stuff just knits back together.
So you make a couple cuts through the bag.
A couple of cuts.
And what's happening here? Oxygen's being introduced.
Oxygen is being introduced. So this bag is otherwise sealed. So it's a high CO2 environment in there. Mushrooms are very much like us. They take in oxygen and they put off CO2. So inside the sealed bag, it's just like CO2. There's moisture. It's growing. It's kind of like inside a tree log or a decomposing log on the forest floor. And when something comes along and chews on the bark, or you know, we trip over a little log and make a cut in it, then the mycelium senses oxygen and moisture and says, "Oh, time to fruit. Time to grow and spread my spores.
It's my time." And then it starts to grow out like this.
This is our fancy, fancy humidity tint that goes over like so. And in the instructions, I mean, it'll explain. You want a few holes in here. Anyone who's ever grown any plants, and many of you here probably have, you know, we need a fresh air exchange. We need
air circulation.
Yeah, air circulation. So you're going to make a few holes in there. And then every day you're going to take your little spray bottle and mist all inside there. You want it to be like lots of condensation, kind of a nice moist environment.
Just water.
Just
all you're spraying.
Just water and indirect light. It doesn't need to be sitting in the dark. These guys are, you're recreating the forest floor in the spring.
So cool.
Yeah.
I love that about how, you know, you're essentially trying to recreate their habitat. And can you tell us a little more about what goes inside of the bag?
Sure.
Like you said, of course, this is the growing substrate, but are the bags different depending on the species? Because of course, different mushrooms fruit on different species of trees. I know that chagas only like birch trees, for example.
That's true. So almost all of our wood-loving mushrooms grow on hardwoods. So you're not going to have anything that has pine or softwoods, which tend to repel fungus. So what we've got in here is a hardwood sawdust. Folks sometimes will take these when you're done with it, and you can actually spread it out in your garden bed. And if you add more hardwood chips or some more hardwood sawdust or some straw even, the mycelium will take over that and continue to grow outside.
That keeps on growing.
It just keeps on going, yeah. If you just keep giving it love, giving it food.
And its food is cellulose, right?
It's cellulose
wood.
Based. That's right. That's
okay.
Right. We do give these guys a little bit of supplementation. So we use mostly waste products from the agricultural industry, and it's all Canadian based. We use Canadian hardwood. We use Canadian soy hulls. So soybean hulls are a waste product of the soybean industry. We use wheat bran. That just gives a little bit extra boost.
Cool. I think that's just so awesome. And that you can, I mean, one species of mushroom that I picked up from you last year was the wine.
Oh, wine caps.
The wine caps. The wine caps, something that you can't just plant in your garden. And
that's
there
right.
are options. If you're not really wanting to grow mushrooms indoors, or maybe you want right. to grow them in your gardens, because mycelium is amazing.
It's really good.
For your gardens. My
yep.
God, it's
yep.
like... You want to create a nice balanced ecosystem in any backyard
yeah.
to attract all different types of pollinators and just mm-hmm. kind of really create some biodiversity. Add some mushrooms, add some wine caps. They're a delicious mushroom.
Yeah.
Super
yeah.
healthy.
Yeah. yeah.
But really, this is all it takes. It's really cool if you've got kids, maybe you're homeschooling, or maybe yeah. you've been teaching home from school. This is something that's so neat to watch grow and
yeah.
really sort of plant that seed, so to speak, of interest in, the natural world around
yeah,
you.
Yeah, exactly. And they just, you know, they spray it, and it's so fast that, you know, the kids, we've worked with some classrooms, so they have their grow kit, and the kids will come back in the morning and they're all excited because it's so much bigger. And
yeah, they
really
definitely double in size each day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The majority of them, at least, apart from the reishi.
Right.
How many different species of mushroom kits do you offer? Do you sell?
Right now we've got the lion's mane, blue oyster, pink oyster, reishi. We are working on, we've got yellow oyster coming.
Ooh.
I know. I've got a little guy, but it's on its third flush and they're just so small. I didn't really have much to show
today.
What
does that mean, third flush?
Okay, so when you get one of these blocks, a lot of people say, oh, okay, so I'll get one mushroom off of it and then it's done. No, we call each fruiting a fruiting or a flush. You'll get one, you harvest it off, and then you start again. You start spraying those spots where you harvested that
off.
They'll regrow. In a couple of weeks,
value.
You're going to have more growing. You'll get about three fruitings or three flushes, and they get a little bit smaller each time. We like to say that on these blocks, typically you're looking at a pound to a pound and a half of mushrooms over the life of the block. So you get your money's worth, and it's really exciting.
It's fun to grow.
It's
a different way to experience
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
So you've got all those different varieties. Do you have a favorite mushroom?
I go round and round. I get into like a certain recipe and I'll just eat it until I'm about sick of it, and then I'll switch to something else. So I've been really into the lion's mane for a long time. I use it as a chicken substitute. We made a
lion's mane lasagna the other day, which is amazing.
Are there any mushrooms that you can't grow in, that Lots. You can't grow? I'm sure.
Yeah.
Like turkey tail?
Well, no, cordyceps. We actually can grow turkey tail.
Okay.
We actually have turkey tail. So one of the things that's been limiting us in particular and a lot of other mushroom growers is it takes some space because you're dealing with trying to incubate. There's a lot of time that goes into where you have to leave all these blocks sit while they're colonizing. We're actually moving into a new facility that will be double the size of what we're in right now. And so we'll be able to bring more of the turkey tail.
More mushroom magic.
We've got chestnuts coming. I've actually got chestnut Ooh. Kits, I know, which are also known as cinnamon caps. We actually are working with some cordyceps strains. There are lots of mushrooms, though, that you cannot grow.
And morels.
Morels cannot be cultivated.
Of course, the delicious, expensive ones.
I know. I say this with a grain of salt because as of now, no one has been able to figure out how to cultivate morels.
Not even Paul.
He's tried. But lots...
The slideshow isn't bringing up that picture. I don't know
oh,
why.
Oh, no, but that's okay.
We'll have to flex on it later.
Right. But yeah, so chaga, which a lot of people know also as a medicinal that you see growing on birch trees around uh-huh. here, can't be cultivated.
Why?
Well, because mainly it's actually parasitic. It
yeah.
works with that birch tree. So unless you have a birch forest,
a living birch tree.
And
so you'd have to have like a forest of trees and farm it off of
sort of like truffles.
Mm.
And again, you know, so you can get the base, like the spores, or you get the little tissue, the piece of the mushroom, and you can try to turn, you know, figure out how to get the mycelium and then get it into the right conditions. But mushroom growers are nerds, and there
really?
Are so many.
Yeah, what?
You can't tell by
no.
the way. But if you go online, there are all these
the coolest nerds.
Where they are, where people are talking about all these different growing techniques, and oh, I tried this, and I think I'm gonna get a morel, but you know,
it's trial and error, and I it feel is. Like that's part of being a scientist.
It's very,
part of exploring
yeah.
the natural world and trying to figure out a way to get it growing and get it going. That's so cool. What about chanterelles? Those are another really
yeah,
delicious.
I get asked about chanterelles all
oh,
the
sure.
time because if you've ever had a chanterelle, you know they're delicious. They're very expensive. And that's, again, because nobody's figured out how to cultivate them yet.
I love that there are so many mysteries that still exist.
That's the coolest
in the
thing.
World.
Yeah, I know.
And I think that mushrooms are, the world of fungi is, mm-hmm. the kingdom of fungi is a huge question mark still.
Oh yeah. It's really sort of in its infancy, trying to understand all those different relationships with the trees and the, you know, the environment and what they're doing under the ground. So
what is the fun fact about human beings being like so much of our DNA is more closely related to mushrooms
yeah.
than like chimpanzees or something?
Yeah. I don't know the exact statistic, but
we are
much more closely aligned with the DNA of fungi than we are with any of the other kingdoms.
So. I'm going to repeat that. We are more closely related to a mushroom than a chimpanzee.
Well, okay. I'm not, I don't
Something
know.
Something along those lines. Look it so. Up. We're not going to confirm it. We're not going to deny it. But I did hear that and I wanted to ask you because
yeah.
I was like, wait,
yeah.
what? There's a we need to look a little closer, I
yes.
think. And that's very much yeah. what I love to talk about. And yeah. Living Wilder, the nature series yep. is about pausing and taking a closer look to realize this just wonderful world that we live in. I mean, if you've seen Avatar,
yeah.
that movie Avatar, you're like, wow, what a beautiful planet that is. That is our planet.
That's
truly.
Right.
Like,
That's right.
just crazy. crazy all the different species and the biodiversity that exists here, even just in the kingdom of fungi alone,
yeah.
is truly fascinating. I could stand up here and talk
oh.
to you forever. I have like 500 more questions. but I think I'll wrap it up. I'll actually ask one more question.
Okay. Yeah.
And that is, if people at home have their button mushrooms, they have their own shiitake mushrooms,
yeah.
are they able to take a piece of that mushroom and inoculate it themselves into their like own log that they've got grown in their backyard? I've got a pretty sweet log in my garden.
Right.
Can I
get that
do
question
that?
A lot. I get that question a lot. And it seems like it would make sense. And in theory, yes. But what actually the problem in nature is that you've got so many other species competing for that nutrition source. So one of the things that we do that makes, you know, the fact us able to grow mushrooms is that we can sterilize our substrate. So after we fill these bags with our substrate, our hardwood sawdust, we actually put it into a steam sterilizer. And then we are clearing out all of those other bacteria, fungi, molds, things that might be competing for the food in there, so that when we inoculate it with that mushroom, it's all by itself. That
it's a very controlled environment.
And if you try to do that at home, you're going to put that little piece in there, and unfortunately, it's probably going to rot, and there's going to be some green stuff, and you know, because we're surrounded by all these floating things. And
yeah, absolutely, yeah. That we can't see or have any idea.
And there's nothing wrong with it.
You're better off to just try out a grow block. What about shiitake steaks? Aren't those a thing?
Oh yeah,
you that can like delicious. Get those and shiitake. Steak. She's like, that sounds yummy. I'm like, no, that's not what I meant.
The plugs. Yeah. The plugs. I was like,
I'll have that for dinner tonight.
So we actually inoculate little wooden dowels, and everybody calls them growing plugs, or, you know, shiitake plugs, or lion's mane plugs, or oyster plugs. It takes a little bit more prep, but if you have a large area of land, or you have some logs that you're not using, hardwood logs, you can prep them, drill some holes in them, buy these little dowels from us that are covered with the mycelium. You hammer them in, you put a little wax or paraffin over that, and then in 6 months to a year, you have a log covered with mushrooms. And it'll come back like a couple
of
years.
And it comes back.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's another item we have on our website.
I am just mind blown. There's so many more things I could chat with you about.
I know we will.
We'll certainly leave some time for questions. If there's any questions in the crowd, please let us know. We've got our lovely lady down the center line with a microphone. If you've got mushroom questions, you've got fungi questions, mushroom questions. Let us know. If not, you're welcome to come and meet us at the side of the stage. Mm-hmm. We do have a question. I knew something was itching. Please.
So when you grow those outside, wouldn't it be competing with wildlife coming to eat that?
So yes, when you're growing them outside, but the nice thing is you've already got this fully colonized mycelium that has already, we've already got it all grown out. So we've done that part. And there's no contamination at that point. So when you put that outside, you may get a little bit of contamination, and I can't do anything about the squirrels, right? They like it, but
you're competing with squirrels.
Same.
Who's going to eat it first?
Right. Same as any garden mushroom body and putting it out there, because until you've got that mycelium really well established, you're going to be competing with other molds and things.
Yeah, you're better off to grow it inside. It's great for urban gardeners too. Like, it really, you can see how much space it takes up. None.
Yeah.
There's no scent. It's not really high maintenance.
No.
Just grow some fresh mushrooms inside. Okay. Did you have another question?
How do we get those?
So I have business cards. Mm-hmm. Thank you for asking. And you can go to our website at thefungiconnection.com. We ship all over Canada. We're also at the Lansdowne Ottawa Farmers Market on Sundays all year round. There tomorrow, have lots of mushroom kits for sale, as well as fresh mushrooms. So you can taste them all before you grow them.
Mm-hmm.
At
the Lansdowne Market, that's where you can find Deb at the Fungi Connection there. Thefungiconnection.com, also on theurbanbotanist.ca. We carry the exact same blocks. Mm-hmm. You're picking up the same one no matter where you go with it.
Right.
I do believe Deb has some here if you would like to purchase a divine, deliciously tasty mushroom kit of your own to give it a try.
Mm-hmm.
They're awesome. Like, what can I say? I don't know. Follow us on Instagram where you can see more mushroom inspiration. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for joining
Thanks
me,
for
Deb.
Having me. It's always my
it
favorite
so
thing to
awesome
talk about.
To talk mushrooms with you. Guys, did we love learning about mushrooms? We loved it. Woo!
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much also to our Lee Valley Tools live stream audience. We so appreciate you tuning in this evening. We'll see you in the next live stream video, and we'll answer any questions that you may have left in Twitch or YouTube or on Facebook. Thanks for tuning in, and we'll see you guys in the next video.
Thank you.
And we'll see you guys at the next presentation. Tomorrow we're doing a talk too, but this was great. Thank you.
We don't currently grow those. It's a whole other realm of way of growing. I know that they used to sell grow kits of those on Mother Earth News. That's actually how Darren got started.
Really?
He bought one of those little grow kits in like a dark box. So
those need the darkness and they need the manure. Portobello.
Yeah. So, it's composted manure. And I'm sure you can find them online, of course. But we don't grow them.
Great question. Yeah.
Anyone else?
Any other questions, Lee Valley? Oh, we have a question. Yeah. Come on up. We wrapped too early. We got more questions. I love it.
Sorry?
There's big mushrooms grow sometimes in the backyard.
Yeah.
In the field.
Are they the big round white ones?
Yeah.
Okay, that's usually going to be called a puffball. If it's all...
I just put them in compost because I don't know what to do.
Those are delicious.
Those are good.
Are they okay to put in the compost?
Chop that one up.
Oh, they're great.